It's a pleasure to introduce Jeppe Bundsgaard today. Jeppe is from the Education Department at Aarhus University in Denmark, but he's been a visiting scholar this year at UC Berkeley. He's been working in the Berkeley Language Center, which indicates one of his areas of interest, the learning of languages. His doctoral thesis, for instance, was on the theory and practice of teaching and learning Danish. His other interests include computers, information, and digital technology in education. Computers are particularly widely used and accepted in Danish schools. And the use of computers in schools is an issue that's important to many of us. So it will be illuminating to hear how a Scandinavian school system approaches it. I'll also mention that Jeppe will be talking about ways of measuring 21st century skills at a Bear Center talk on May 2nd at 2 o'clock in this room. Today he'll be talking about innovative teaching and learning in a Danish perspective. Please join me in welcoming Jeppe Bundsgaard.
Thank you very much, and thank you for inviting me. Just to remind you about Denmark, it's the little thing on top of continental Europe. It looks very big. It's this a tenth of California in size, 5.5 million people. So we are not big, but we have great confidence in ourselves. We are a welfare society of the European model, social democratically governed from time to time, and then sometimes governed by liberal or conservative governments, but they would be like liberal in the American sense. When international organizations measure things, one of the things they measure are the readiness for IT societies, and Denmark usually comes out on the top, also when it comes to use in education. I'll get back to that. Today I'll talk about innovative education, and in my view, of course, it includes use of computers, but one of the points that we are trying to make in the education research area in Denmark is that computers should be always be thought of as the second part of the sentence in some way. So we need to talk about developing education and use computers for that, instead of use computers and then think about what to use them for. So, and that'll be one of my conclusions as well today. Just shortly to tell a little more about Denmark, and one of you have heard it before, but I'll come to something new in a minute. So, but Denmark has this law about education, or about how to perform primary and secondary school education. And in that law, there's a purpose description. And I think it's in many ways, it encompasses what we in Denmark think about what education should do. It's not necessarily what we do, but it's something to steer after. So one of the goals is to promote the many-sided personal development of the individual pupil, not only to prepare for further education, but to consider students as human beings that have all kinds of personalities, and they need to be developed, both their creativity and their social life and so on. So the goal is to have teaching and learning so that pupils develop awareness, imagination, and acquire confidence in their own possibilities and a background for committing themselves and taking action. So we have what I consider a pretty, we are trying to create citizens in all the meanings of that word. And therefore, the daily life of the school must build on intellectual freedom, equality, and democracy, and prepare pupils for participation, joint responsibility, rights, and duties. I think that's a beautiful way of saying what education is all about, and it's a good thing to refer to when you talk about how schools should develop. 2 years ago, 3 years ago, we had a great reform big reform. Not necessarily great, reform of many parts of the Danish school. Among other things, we developed new common goals or common core, as you would call them, that are competence-based, which means that they are focused not on what the students know or how they can do math, but they are focused on how students can use their competences in real life situations. We also have three cross-disciplinary focus areas: IT and media, which has been a part of the curriculum earlier, but now it's very clearly stated in this cross-disciplinary area. We have an area called innovation and entrepreneurship, formulated in a way that it's not only for the students to become entrepreneurs in business, but to think creatively and be able to develop solutions for all kinds of communities and situations. And there's a cross-disciplinary focus area on language, like you have here, writing across the curriculum in that line of thinking. So in my opinion, a rather innovative curriculum. Not everybody in Denmark would agree on that. There's a lot of discussion, of course, about what it is good for, if it is good to have these kind of descriptions. In Denmark and in continental Europe, we use this word didactics, and I know that many of you would find it strange, but it's very hard for us to say it in English or to use other words in English, because in some ways it means teaching approaches and methods, but it also means thinking about the goals of education and what we should teach and what so the purpose would be an area of didactics. So I don't think you have a word for that in English, so I think you need to remodel the didactics word into more broad concept. So teachers have freedom method, and that's very important for them, so they can decide themselves how to teach. They just need to teach towards the goals. And through time we have had a very, in many ways, innovative and engaged teaching profession. They have developed a wide variety of methods, from team-based work to storyline, inquiry-based education, project and problem-based education. Some of them are developed here in the States, others in Europe, and some even in Denmark, I think. The team-based work is a Danish method. So, and many schools are experimenting or have introduced and are using different ways of reorganizing the school day. So they would have project-based work in the morning, and then more subjects organized work in the afternoon. And many schools are still pretty rather traditional, just having lessons all the day, like you have. But all schools in Denmark we are organized in that way that the students are together in class, like you are in elementary school here. But in many schools, I think you change into having, you go to different classes as a student here. But in Denmark, all the way through K through 9, and even in most of high school, students are in a class, so the teachers come to them. And that, I think, that makes many difference. Okay, and we have, I think we also need to talk a little about pedagogies, because I think that's also something special for the Nordic countries, maybe. We have a rather egalitarian relationship between adults and children in the Danish society, and that's also apparent in schools. Teachers are called by their first name, have been there since the 60s. Students are allowed a wide degree of freedom of behavior, and that's some of the things we're discussing, because it gives a lot of disciplinary problems, of course, but also it develops students' creativity and their sense of participation. And their opinions and creativity are valued. We have only grades given in 8th and 9th grade, so before that there are no formal grades, but of course some teachers experiment with giving grades in earlier grades. Our testing system has been more and more going towards having more tests, but we are not by any means as geared towards testing, as we see here in the States. So we have a final exams, which we have had like forever, after ninth grade, which is today it's both written composition and multiple choice and oral exams in all different kinds of subjects. And as part of the final exam, the students have a 1 week project where they investigate some kind of problem in cross-disciplinary way and present it in the end. And computers are allowed at many exams, even in some exams they are demanded. And right now, students are getting access to the internet. We've been having that as an experiment for some years, but now they are allowed or even demanded access to the internet in the written exam in Danish and in some of the language subjects. And we have this national computer-based adaptive testing each year, or not each year, but 10 times during the 9 years of schooling from second to ninth, eighth grade actually. So it's not many tests, but it's an area of discussion because they are very badly, they're working very badly technically, and they are making teachers teaching more to the test, which is very bad because they are testing something very technical and not innovative. And the last thing I'll say about the system is that we have, as I've already said and as you've said, we have had a very much focus on use of computers in education since the 80s actually. We have had several large-scale projects from government, from the side of the government, both introducing computers, interactive whiteboards and tablets, supporting development of digital learning material and improving infrastructure in different ways. And the last one was a big project where the government supported schools' acquisition of learning material, so they funded 50%. And this has boosted the market for digital learning material very much. So today I'll say, without bragging, Denmark is in front. It's not necessarily something to be proud of, because we've done a lot of stupid things, I'll say, invested a lot in hardware without knowing actually what to use it for. But the good thing is that the basis is good for actually using IT for something more clever. So all schools have high-speed internet. We have on average 29 students per interactive whiteboard, and that was in 2013, so I guess that's almost one per class. So teachers could expect to have a whiteboard when they teach. We have on average 3 students per computer, and many schools ask their students to bring their computers, and they actually use it, which is of course a good thing if you want them to bring them. But what happened in the beginning was that they were asking them to bring them but didn't use them, and then of course they stopped bringing them, and that's what I see my kids do here in Sweden. And we have 99% of teachers who use computers at least once a week to prepare teaching, and 79% who use them in class at least once a week. So it's a pretty common thing to use computers. There was one more. So we have our teaching material are developed by private publishers. There are no kind of authorization process and no peer reviewing or anything, which makes it very, some of the teaching materials are okay and some are very bad. We see an increasingly digital teaching material, which is caused by the funding by the government. So today 50% of the teaching material used in 7th to 9th grade is digital, according to a survey that I did together with two of my colleagues recently. And 22% in 4th to 6th and 10% in K through 3rd grade. But now I've told you all the things that I would consider very good things about, mostly good things about Danish primary secondary school, but when we actually look into what are the teaching material that schools teachers actually use, what characterizes this teaching materials, and this is from the survey that we did. We asked Danish teachers a representative sample of Danish teachers, so in Danish subject, which teaching material that they have been using for the last 2 months, and they could say five different things. Then we collected, organized, characterized it, and one of the results are here. So we see, for example, then that when we look into the content of the teaching material, we have grammar, lexical competence, spelling, handwriting, rhythm composition, so on, of communication analysis, literature analysis, and so on. So what we see is the two most used content areas are spelling, which is okay, spelling is important to spell, but almost 30% of the analog teaching material content are about spelling, which we find pretty strange. There are many things you should teach, but not necessarily spelling 30% of the time. The other large group is concerned with literature analysis. So we split between literature analysis and literature interpretation, where we see analysis of something you need to do before you interpret and discuss literature. But it's interesting that the ratio is like 3-1 or something like that. So three times more analysis than actually working with the content of the literature. So in many ways, I've considered this traditional, not what the content should be about. It should be more about multimodal reading and composition, maybe more about literature interpretation, maybe more about communication analysis, media, maybe more about orality and having a democratic dialogue. But this is what we see. But one of the interesting things is, of course, that spelling is connected to the analog teaching material, not to the digital. That was a surprise to me. I would expect digital learning materials to be right down the aisle for correcting spelling mistakes. But I think it's a good thing if they haven't chosen the easy way. Another interesting thing is that we looked into the pedagogical approaches. So we differentiated between the four different approaches, or five actually, but we didn't see much of the fifth. So we looked at repetitive approaches like drill and practice, fill out the blanks, production oriented, so the students were asked to produce something, written or multimodal texts. Instructivist, this is where the teachers should teach the students content of some kind. Scaffolding approaches, where the teachers should let the students do some work and scaffold, or the teaching materials helps teachers scaffold students' work. And then we had this practice scaffolding approach, where students are doing some real life problem solving and get scaffolds of the practice they are in. So what we see in the first through third grade is a very high amount. So three was the highest amount that the teaching materials could get, and on average it's 2.6 or something like that. When it comes to digital, it's also quite high. So students are filling out blanks in the elementary school. While this is wrong, so it should be 7th through 9th grade there. Move that over there. So, and what you see here is that we have a more focus on the scaffolding approach, so more focus on supporting students in acquiring the academic content. And again, you see a very interesting difference between analog and digital. So digital seems to have moved towards more scaffolding practices. Another way we have investigated this is from the demonstration school projects that I will talk about later. We did, at the beginning of the project, called the baseline, we did observation study of the 16 participating schools, 600 lessons of teaching. I think we had students to observe in a digital observation tool. And what we saw different things. This is the pictures of different teaching approaches that we actually see in practice. We differentiated between constructive problem solving, authentic tasks, and training tasks. And this is the constructed no, this is the constructive problem solving, this is the authentic tasks, and these are training tasks in other subjects. So this is everything but Danish and math. And what you see in Danish is that it has like 50% like the other subjects of training, 15% of authentic tasks and math, no authentic tasks, 80% of training tasks and 20% of constructive problem solving. So even though Denmark is a pretty progressive country when it comes to teaching and pedagogies, I'll say that in its own self-understanding, we are still pretty traditional in our teaching practices. So, and the last thing I'll say about the understanding that we have gained about the practices that we were expecting to be more progressive is that in the ICILS study, it's a study of international computer information literacy study. Denmark was part of it. I was the national research coordinator for that study. The Danish students were rather good at computer information literacy. They were in the top third. Only Czech Republic scored higher. It was all kinds of countries from Australia to Argentina to a lot of European-like countries. The interesting thing is that Danish students used computers for word processing and spreadsheets above the international average, while they used computers for multimedia, graphics and presentations and programming less than the international average. That surprised me. I would expect Danish students to be more using more progressive approaches than other countries, but that wasn't the case. What was interesting was that Danish teachers was above mean, just slightly above mean when it comes to positive views on using computers, while they were below mean on negative views on using computers. So Danish very much below, it's like 80% of the state standard deviation below the international average. And this can actually be the case, that you can be very positive and also be negative, but Danish teachers were very positive and very, very little negative on the use of IT. So in many ways, this shows that we have introduced computers and actually are using them. So now to the topic. So we have been, in recent years, we have been acquiring more and more understanding of the rather traditional practices, and we have been asking each other, how can that be that having a pretty progressive history and a pretty progressive understanding of teaching and learning, why is teaching so traditional when we look at it as a whole? And how could we work with teachers and schools in order to support more progressive teaching practices? And that is what I'll talk about from now on. First, I'll very shortly talk about the theoretical foundations for this kind of thinking. So, one of the theoretical persons we are talking much about is John Dewey, of course, Democracy and Education from 1916. It's a main work of, main book that we use. So the student-centered education, authentic problems, that would be Dewey and Kilpatrick. Wagenschein is a German didactician, is what we would call him. He introduced the idea of representative problems. So in German, exemplarisches Lernen, which means that it doesn't make any sense to teach students everything. We need to find the most informative problems and try to teach them these problems, because then they can understand the things that makes them able to understand other problems as well. And we use Klafke, another German didactician, to talk about important content. He talks about problems that are central to the epoch we are living in. He talks about how to decide what to teach. And then we use a lot from the modern learning sciences, for example, as collected in Keith Sawyer's Handbook of the Learning Sciences from 2006. So about collaborative learning, about the importance of variating the context of teaching and learning, and about scaffolding, of course. Okay, so I did this study that I'll present, or I'm in the middle of doing this study. I'm trying to understand what we have been doing the last 10 years in Denmark, and this is the advantage of being a small country. It's actually possible to contact all researchers in the area and ask them what they have been doing, and I know much of it in, already, actually. But I did that. I contacted 40 researchers. That was what I could find. I think there are maybe 10, 15 that I overlooked, and I asked the others to help me find them out. And asked them by mail what they've been working on the last 10 years. Until now, I've got responses from 14 researchers. That covers a little more, because some of them works together, and they just, one of them answered me. So my method is to do a literature review and also to communicate, simply to communicate with the researchers. So what I'll do now is to present you for some of the projects that have been, that are ongoing or finished in Denmark. The overall characteristic, I think, is that we have a wide variety of teaching approaches that are being tried out or developed. Game-based learning, inquiry-based science education, storyline approaches, project-based learning, open schools. So a lot of researchers are working with museums and other out-of-school opportunities for learning. The maker movement are becoming big in Denmark, robots, so on. We have a wide variety of research approaches, but they are almost all qualitative. So it's design-based research, action research, ethnographic studies, professional development research, and so on. And a few quantitative studies as well. So one example is FabLab at school. I start with that because you might know it. It's started by Paolo Blickstein at the Stanford University. I don't know if it's okay to mention it's okay. I think it's a very interesting project. It's an approach that tries to use design thinking to help students be able to investigate, that is Danish for investigate, create, and how would you call it, set in scene, present, think about, reflect upon what we have been doing. So they use typically digital technologies to produce something of material existence. They have all kinds of creation approaches. They use fabric and computers, 3D printers, and so on. So they did a research or the survey at their baseline, and they are just finishing right now, so in the next half year they'll come out with their final results. But they were surprised, as we have been, that students are very much consumers rather than producers, because that's what everybody is talking about, young students today, they are producing and so on. But what they saw in their survey was that they're mostly consumers of digital media and technology. Few students have knowledge of digital fabrication. Schools focus on teaching what they call office literacy, like using word processing and presentation software. Most students do not act on their creative ideas. They thought that they could see that many students have creative ideas, but they are not able to actually get something created upon them. And students lack knowledge of design processes. So they've been doing a lot of studies. One of them, the studies that I found interesting, is that they were they have observational studies where they actually find many of the same things. So students find it hard to conceptualize a digital fabrication process. They are challenged in navigating the messy process of fabrication. Lack experience of collaborative creation. They have limited engagement. And then they lack understanding of augmentation surrounding digital fabrication. But they were able to design a teaching practice where, in some degree, integrating digital fabrication into formal educational context it's not a straightforward straightforward process, but it's able to benefit this, from design thinking as an integrated part of the educational setup. So it seems that they are able to actually solve some of these problems, but it remains to be shown how it more precisely work. That will come in the next 6 months time. Another project, very interesting I think, is use of game-based learning, in this case Minecraft, in K through 2. So it's used as a part of a storyline project. So students are building I don't know if you know that word, but you know Robinson Crusoe, and if you make a story like a storyline like Crusoe, you'd call it a Robinsonade. I think it would be a French word, and it's a Danish word, but it means a story like Robinson Crusoe. And the students build this story, and then they design things in Minecraft to support their communication of the story. If two students, they are doing that. So the goal was developing 21st century skills like it is these days. And this is actually what I just said. They collaboratively develop a storyline. What they do is that they discuss how to construct something that they can present as a part of the project. And integrated in this, they write a lot, diaries, short stories, etc. And they end up presenting either by recollection or by let's play video or by public presentations. This project, of course, should have been followed up by a pre-test, post-test study. That would have been good because then we could have seen it work. But as many other projects, it's a qualitative study. So these conclusions are based on qualitative studies, not quantitatives. So what the researchers saw was great engagement, that the project related to students' everyday domain, a lot of good opportunities for collaboration in an open but structured universe. And I think this is one of the things that is a very central part of what we have been learning in Denmark in recent years, that we have this theory of project-based work as something where students are set free to have fun and learn. But what we have learned is that we need to be very structured when we do that. I'll come back to that again and again, I think. So one of the challenges that were experienced in the project is that teachers lack experience, of course, with Minecraft, but also with use of games in a more broad manner in education. And these researchers have seen that over and over again. And it's of course a challenge for game-based research or game-based education that it's a good idea, but you need to teach the teachers a lot before they are actually able to do it well. So there's a need for IT support and extra preparation time to get to know the technology. So, and one of the solutions they see in their rather small study is that it works best for teams of teachers where there's a common interest and commitment, and it's very important for teachers to take ownership. And this is also some of the findings that we find again and again. We have this, of course, the challenge of a centrally, in some way, a centrally governed school, and when we come with good ideas, the teachers are not necessarily agreeing on that being good ideas. Another example in elementary school is this project that I was part of. It's an entrepreneurship education approach where students are working from, it's called Hidepo in Danish, it's not directly translated, but I think Think Of would be a direct translation of innovative thinking making. But it's built up on these four steps. So the students should, or before they discover, they should actually see a problem, or that's maybe what Discover is about. So they should discover the problems investigate the problems, dream up solutions, create the solutions using material and digital solutions, and they should share in the end. So this is one of the central parts of the project, is that we developed this card, I think it would be called, of materials. So it's all kind of reusable. It's paper, it's plastic things, it's all kinds of tools and so on, so that students use in their creative process of solving problems. So you can see students working with these things. One of the interesting things is that we, in this project, we actually did a pre-test, pro-test study. We developed this test where we ask students to draw an idea that will do a difference, that will make your school better, and then we ask them to write about your idea and draw how you will make your idea and write how you will make your idea. And you can see four different examples of students' responses to this. We did this pre-test, pro-test, developed scoring guides, and ended up having four different dimensions that we measured, and we had a control group, and the classes were randomly chosen from the municipality that participated. But it's a rather small study, but we ended up having an effect on 0.28, and this was a project with teaching interventions of, there were four different teaching materials supporting different approaches during half a year of teaching. So I think it's an okay effect. And it was on what we called innovative writing competence, which was measuring the ideas presented and explained, the variation in verbs and actors. So do they use I only, or we, or do they actually talk about people outside of that, use of subclauses, etc. And when we could also measure writing skills understood as their spelling and correctness, and their drawing and process competences. There were positive but non-significant effects on these three. So I think the main point is that the students did not get worse at spelling, but they got better at what's actually important, writing. And we had a qualitative study as part of that. Some teachers were having problems not teaching spelling, so they, or reading in the technical understanding. So they had a hard time accepting that that could be learned as part of a more holistic approach. They found it to be difficult with students so young. Some teachers did, some teachers actually reorganized the whole organization of teaching in first and second grade after, or during the project actually. And others thought that it should be for the best students and that the weak students should practice reading. And I think this is an example of traditional thinking that weak students should train or even train technical aspects of reading instead of actually learning how to use reading in a more holistic approach. And of course, again, it showed that the process of being creative and select idea was not easy and needed support and scaffolding from the teachers. And this is one of the things that teachers clearly need to learn, to practice themselves, to support students. Another project, it's an interesting but small project done by two mathematicians, or math didacticians. Language. So they used robots as tools to investigate mathematical domains and as tools to learn how to think algorithmically. And it's a small project, but I think it's interesting that they see this, and we see this over and over again, this potential conflict between freedom and intended learning goals. So students get so involved in making these robots make them do things, driving around school or whatever, and that they forget, or that they are doesn't care about, they don't care about the skills and the knowledge that the teachers have thought they should work with. Another example is a big European project, also not finished yet, so it's only preliminary results that I can show. So the goal was to use inquiry-based science education to increase students' motivation for science, and they used augmented reality animations for doing that, or are using. So they have this sense of success. Students are typically motivated and engaged when working productively and creatively. Again, this is qualitative results. So it's it's a problem. It's very hard to talk about these things based on a qualitative empirical data without using things, words that are meant for or only could be based on quantitative data. But they see this, again, need for guidance. Students need room for playful, collaborative inquiry, but it's very important to supply differentiated guidance for the students. And again, this is the challenge for teachers in this project, as in the other projects. And again, they see the same challenge, that the focus on the academic content can be lost. I think Bridget Barron, again, from Stanford University, had this schism between activism and deep learning, and I think we see that again and again, that students are having great fun, but they actually forgot what they learned, or they didn't learn what they were intended to learn. So the discussion is how to prepare students for the project, or how to give them just-in-time knowledge that they can actually work with and focus on deep learning. So, and again, what they see is that it's not easy for teachers. It's challenged by the content. It's not easy to be a teacher where you should actually have all content ready and be able to advise or supervise the students in how to use content. It's not easy to organize this kind of work, and it's teachers might have lack of content area knowledge actually. So the last project I'll talk about in a little. I'll use a little more time, but I'm almost done, is about the demonstration school projects. It was 5 different projects, but we had 3 projects in the same project, supported by the Danish government or the Ministry of Education. 15 schools, all in all, $2 million of support for schools and the research projects. What we did was to produce a common change theory where we tried to use much of this experience we've gained the years before about it doesn't work if you only introduce technological solutions. You need to think both technologically, didactical in this broad sense of the word, and organizational at the same time. So you need also to make the school ready for this kind of project. So we work with the school in order to, for example, to solve problems with organization of the school day or access to computers, access to other kind of technological things, access to help and so on. For example, we in some schools we help them develop what we call a media patrol. It's built on top of we have some patrols of students standing at the roadside when school day starts and ends to manage traffic and other students, and we did that for, so we made students help other students using computers and help teachers as well as part of the organizational solutions. And we had a lot of different ways of working didactically with teachers. I'll come a little back to that. And then we tried to understand all the different things that make a difference, and we try to investigate and do research into how these things work together. So different kinds of schools, culture, infrastructure differences, organization of schools, teacher types, teaching methods, didactical profiles, so what's the profile of teachers, and the student types as well. And our outcome goals was 21st century skills. It was teacher time free. That was the government's or the ministry's goal. We didn't take that very seriously, but because of course you can't gain time by doing something more difficult than you're used to. Innovative teaching and innovative school culture. And so what we did was we developed lesson plans for innovative teaching based on many different methods and did it differently in the three projects. So one project was very much focused on lesson plans. The two others more used it as inspiration. So we had inspirational and didactic material. We introduced some kinds of software or developed software, especially software to support teachers' insight into students' learning experiences and to support teachers' goal-oriented planning practices. We developed we developed plans for the development processes and the procedures to support the organizational challenges. And we had a lot of different professional development activities with the teachers. So we had consultants working with teachers locally and across schools. They did different things in the three different projects. In one project, it was more like a delivery, and in the other project, it was more like teachers trying to work out solutions to the problems that they had identified and consultants supporting them. And we did that in order to be able to see the difference between those two approaches. And as I said, organizational development procedures and organizational technology support and more. In these projects, we had both quite many different quantitative evaluations. So you already saw the observation study, some of the results from that. We have surveys, we have 21st century skills. It's actually the test from that project that I'm presenting on May 2nd. 21st century skills. We collected teaching material and many other things. It was quite overwhelmingly much. And then we did qualitative research across the three projects. So we looked at school organizations and differences in the three projects of doing that and what we could learn from that. And we did research into the projects themselves, into single lesson plans, how they were used and so on. So and it turned out quite good actually. We were able to show that teachers in the projects were actually developing more innovative teaching and understanding of innovative teaching practices. We also showed that teachers, when they work together on professional development practices with focus on development and evaluation of teaching practices and material, they actually develop more innovative teaching practices. And this was one of the goals that was a good thing, and students in projects did develop in some cases. This was not global, but they developed stronger 21st century skills in some cases. And one of the lessons that we learned in this project, as we have learned before, is that technology is the wrong driver, as Michael Fullan said many years back or some years back. But it, in many people's heads, technology is still the driver. So for the ministry, they thought of it as an important driver, and for some schools as well. So some schools even had this. They thought that what we came with was not technologically advanced enough. So it was pretty normal use of normal software. And they thought, hey, we are way ahead of this. We use drones or all kinds of things. I think I'm not necessarily right, but that was what we met and one of the things that we had to deal with. So I think the main lesson that we have learned in these projects and in all the other projects is, of course, that teachers are the key to success. So there's no one single solution. So we cannot just develop better teaching material or introduce computers or make things teacher-proof. We need to make our teachers better at what they are doing, or that's the wrong way of formulating it, because we need to make the teachers able to make themselves better and collaborate to make a community of teaching that is more progressive that we see in many situations today. So we need to support them to develop their didactical and their technical competences. At the same time, we need to have the teachers feel in control. We need to understand that changes in teaching practices are something that's not happening from one day to the other, and that it demands a long-term, locally-based, collaborative professional development. This is, I would say that that was the core of the three projects, and that's clear. That is clearly what worked in the three projects, but it's also what had a lot of challenges, of course, and different challenges in different schools. But we also need to develop something that they can work with. It's wrong to think that teachers can develop everything from the bottom up themselves. So teachers used the material that we came with, and that helped them develop more innovative practices. So we need to set idealistic goals, but they need to be realistic at the same time. So you could say that this is the final conclusion of what I've been saying today, that IT is a good driver if you use it to support progressive teaching, which if progressive teaching is what your goal is. But so technology is important, and so is infrastructure, which has been the focus of many projects. But we need to focus on organization of schools at the same time. We need to look at the school culture, what is deemed valuable and important at this school, and how can we work with this culture. We need to work with teachers' competences, as I said, in long-term collaborative collaboration. And we need to work with teaching material. And we need to do this concurrently, so it doesn't work if you only focus on one of these goals. We need to work on them all at the same time. That was the last slide, and thank you. So now it's time for you to say something. Yes?
Basically, I'm curious, what can you say about the kind of teacher education programs, and do you see that the kind of rise in use in technology is, or computers, is reflected in those programs too?
Yeah, we have a four-year teacher education, which is, so they start at teacher education, so it's a college-like education, but they have decided to become teachers when they start. So they are teachers from first to ninth grade. If they want to be teachers in high school, they go to college or university, as we call it, and decide to become teachers later on. But so that's, in Denmark we have special work. It's different between those two. So that's a lot of, actually I think it's a lot more of pedagogy and didactics than it's subject related teaching and learning. And I think that's a problem in some ways, because the teachers are very good at being teachers, but not necessarily so good at their content areas. When it comes to use of computers, they have been way behind in many years, as have been the case all over the world, I think. And it's a good question, who is to blame? I think I was a college teacher back in 2000, and at that time I thought it was a little embarrassing, so little computers were used, but I think so I tried to use them a little, but it was, nothing happened for many years, I'll say. But I think today it has also become clear to teachers, teacher called teachers that they are supposed to use computers and they are interested in using them. Many more of them are interested, and there's a lot more support for it. But it's still at a pretty basic level, so that's clearly a problem. But I think it doesn't make any sense just to blame them, or because there are all kinds of organizational reasons. But it wouldn't help if they were 100% digital-based teaching. There would still be like many teachers that would have to learn it in service training. Yeah.
Connected to that question, I work with teachers, and I was talking to a group the other day who were telling me that they collectively use less technology in class now, less computers in class now, than they did each of them 7 or 8 years ago, because the school infrastructure is so unreliable that their lessons fall apart too frequently. And I just wondered if you can talk about like the physical and IT infrastructure of schools, and if you looked at anything along those lines, and whether the story is similar.
It's not. In Denmark, we've been like investing huge amount of money in hardware, in an infrastructure. And at some points I've been rather critical towards that, because it has been like we are investing in iPads like millions, or not millions, it's a small country, but thousands of iPads without knowing why we are investing in that, or whiteboards without knowing what they were useful for. But the advantage is that it has been continuing, and in the latest latest government initiative, there was a 50-50 investment. So when the government invested 50% of this many million dollars, the municipalities were supposed to invest the same amount of money in infrastructure. So the internet is good almost everywhere, even though it has been huge problem, not more of a problem than you would expect. And the computers are up to date, and schools are beginning to ask students to take their own laptops or iPads or so on. So I think it's not a problem of having technology available today. It's like in the last 5 years it has become not a problem at all. So and in some ways that's good, because then they can, and now there's actually also teaching material available for them for all subjects or in all grades, and that's also very important, because this thought that teachers could develop their teaching from bottom up themselves is of course wrong. But a few years back I would have a lot of teachers saying the same. Yes?
Can you talk about the admission system, like how students go from like middle school to high school, changes with the change of increased use of technology? Like how what's the influence of the use of technology for the admissions?
In Denmark we have a goal of that all students should go to high school or some kind of vocational school. It's still not training, but school combined with training. So, and just recently we got they should have a certain grade to go into high school. And this has been much debated in Denmark. We are not much fond of grades. So there was almost free access to whatever. If teachers deemed you ready for high school, you were going to go to high school. So in that way, there haven't been no connection between use of IT and admission into higher levels. So when you go from high school to university, then the grades begin to mean something. We don't have a SAT or anything. It's the high school grades that decides if you are can go into the study that you want. But you will always be able to go into some kind of
further education after high school. So I can't say anything about the connection between technology and admissions. Okay. Yes.
So this is very interesting. Thank you very much. I really found it fascinating. So you started out by saying you had this sort of Vygotskian, Deweyish philosophy for instruction, and then you showed us a table where it looked like the curriculum materials that were available didn't actually align with that image, and then you showed us three projects where it seems like that's the effort, is to try to create this. But I guess I wonder, is there support for building curricula that align with the philosophy, or to look for a curricula that might, you know, be appropriate to customize or redesign to fit in? And if so, what are the kinds of things that you're looking at?
It's interesting that we have this philosophy that we, I think, share. Teachers share it, and teacher educators, and the purpose of the school shares it. But I think the challenge is that teaching material is developed by private companies, and there isn't. It's not that there haven't been much discussion about the quality of these teaching materials. So that's actually what we are trying to do, to actually look into what it is all about. And I hope so. These results hasn't been published yet, and I hope that there'll be a lot of discussion, because it'll clearly be a surprise to many that they look as they do. So when the government made this last funding digital teaching material, one of the things that they started by just supporting digital teaching material, and then in the next round they began to have some demands upon the teaching material, so it should be interactive and then they began to use the words that we used, so repetitive, scaffolding, instructional, and tried to promote more scaffolding kind of material. So, but it's in a market controlled way, because it's the teachers who, or it's becoming more and more the municipality actually who buy the teaching material, but it's not up to the central government to decide the teaching material. And they've been discussing should they have some kind of authorization process, but they haven't been willing to do that. And I think it's good not to do it. I would prefer it to be some kind of a collaborative project. But clearly it's a problem.
But there isn't support for it right now. I mean, you can't get a grant to bring the teachers together to build a set of materials.
No.
Okay.
Yeah.
It strikes me that the Danish government is perfectly happy to tell exactly what has to be covered in grade 6, grade 7, and grade 8. So that means that even though the people who write the textbooks may be of private nature, they certainly have a lot of directions of what should go in them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and they have solved the problem in. Before this, they are still solving it in that way that they are, so they take the curriculum, so the common goals, and put them in their material and put little signs before them and say, so we cover all these goals. But when you look into the materials, it doesn't actually cover the goals. But it's a nice way of saying that you can.
Advertising.
Yeah. Yeah. So this material covers all the Danish subjects. That would be a typical, but when you look into it, it's just not true. And there's nothing to check it. Yes.
I was wondering, because your curriculum is so decentralized, could you describe a little bit, if there are a lot of informal social networks for teachers to help build each other's practice and for like ongoing professional development between, you know, your professional, your formal trainings? Like, are there a lot of like Facebook pages or listservs that connect teachers together to build their practice?
Yeah, until a few years ago we had a network specially designed for teachers and students, but there was a special area for teachers called school comm, so school communication. And teachers were posting teaching materials of all kinds there. I think that has been, it doesn't work anymore, I think. But anyway, now they are of course using Facebook and the internet in many different ways, but we have also seen development of what is called learning platforms. So actually there's a support for teachers to develop their own teaching material or curriculum and share it among their colleagues at their school or in a for a wider audience. Until now, I think it hasn't worked very well. It's a dream, of course, that we would support this kind of sharing and collaborative creation, but I think it works worse than it did before. And as part of the 2014 reform, there was a reform of the teaching, work conditions. So they got a lot less hours for preparations, and they were, so there was a lot of the teachers were locked out actually by the municipalities, so they were not allowed to work because they weren't accepting this deal. So they ended up having to accept the deal, and they're still mad about that. So they have, I think a lot of good things have stopped because of this. So they're not, right now I think they're not collaborating that much as they were a few years back. It's not a good idea to destroy the student teachers' unions, I'd say. I think people are the same.
I was just thinking, with all the technology innovations, there are more and more ways to connect virtually, mm-hmm. using technology,
yeah.
so that you're integrating technology into professional practice for
yeah.
professional development,
yeah.
not just for teaching.
Yeah, and we do that, and teachers do that, but I think it is in a valley right now. I hope that it will go up again, and of course there are a lot of options, but I also think that we have a lot of imaginations that things would happen, and we can point to teachers that do things, but the common teacher doesn't do that much. So I think we need to work actually very locally and very face-to-face with teachers.
I'm not entirely sure if this is part of your research, but I was kind of wondering, like, how would you advise the current educational system in the U.S. to kind of adopt some of these ideas? Because the first thing that comes to my mind are, like, income disparity and just the amount of, like, resources provided in different districts, and then also there's being like a racial divide. I'm just wondering, how do you apply these same concepts in the United States?
I haven't been asked to do that, but I think some of the core differences are actually differences in the overall system. So we have this welfare system, and our schools are not funded. It's not so much funded based on how rich the people in the community are, but of course it's funded by the municipalities, and they have different levels of welfare, but overall it's a pretty equal amount of money that they are paid, but it's far too little, I would say. But of course when it comes to all kinds of inequalities, they are a lot smaller in Denmark than they are here. So our problems are small in many ways, but we do have schools with high amounts of immigrants and high amounts of working poor people of all kinds, and that's of course a problem, but we solve it by giving them more money instead of fewer, which I think is the wise thing to do. So, but I think I would advise your society to become a welfare society if you solve the problems, these problems. But I see a lot of innovative teaching and learning. I think I'm very inspired actually by what's going on here. So much of the things that we are doing are inspired by what we are seeing going on here. But it seems like it's going on in very small islands, or researchers doing good things with a few schools and that more broadly. Yeah?
I'm also curious about the schedules in the schools that you were looking at. Do they have, were there differences between like how their daily schedule was worked out? Were they block schedules or stuff like that? Just because I, from having been in a classroom, like some of the stuff that you're talking about is much easier depending on the time scale.
Yeah, that was one of the things we were working with the schools on the organizational level. So, but as I had said at some point, I said a lot of things, but a lot of schools are experimenting with different kinds of block schedules. And so a lot of schools have moved towards blocks of 90 minutes or even 120 minutes with breaks, but typically with the same subject in all the, in the whole block. And as I said, or I didn't say it, but I tried to say that we have, so it's not, every day is not the same. So what I see here is that you have the same schedule Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and so on, while, or...
It depends.
Okay, yeah. So, but in our schools it's always different. So we have different schedules on different days. And that means in some schools, for example, you have one whole day that you have freed for what you could call project-based work or... So the days of the subject, so different subjects have a whole day for their, so that makes it possible actually to go out of school to the forest or to the museum or to the company in the neighborhood. Or, so it's all kinds of different organizations, and I think that's one of the interesting things that's going on, that schools are actually experimenting with different solutions and learning from each other. So we are moving away from six lessons in one day to different organizations.
So when you did the study, when you were doing the different projects in different schools, were the schedules all the same in your subject schools? So some of the variation may have been scheduled.
Yeah, the variation were huge, and that's the challenge of making a pretest process study as we did. It's in many ways not possible because there were so many things going on. But I think that's part of the discussion that we need to have. How can we... Because if we had pushed everything into the same system, it wouldn't have been the real, it wouldn't be realistic.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Thank you very much. Wonderful talk.
And thank you for all the good questions.